started playing the violin when I was 7 years old, so I started taking music lessons at a very, you know, fairly early age.
Mm-hmm.
And I was always interested in music and playing music, and I was always involved with other people that were involved in music, and conductors and composers. I played with the New York Youth Symphony in New York City, and got to play in Carnegie Hall, so I met with Jeff Coleman, and I met other really wonderful artists that always encouraged us to keep practicing, keep playing, keep, you know, just keep it up and see where it would take us. And I was always such a nice group of people, and I really made wonderful friends. But even after college, when, you know, it became clear I was going to be a musician, I always wanted to do something with my hands. I've always been, always had that hand-eye connection and the creative practice with practicing and trying and making bad noises and then making good noises. And so I was ready for something like this. I started taking some pottery classes. And the pottery classes led to sculpture, and the sculpture led to drawing, and the drawing led to painting, and the painting led to more drawing, and led to 3D printing. And I don't know where it's going to take me next, but it's not going to be, I hope it won't be boring. I think it'll be, it's always really fun to wake up in the morning and have that moment of thinking, ooh, what's downstairs? Like, what's in the kiln there? How did that pink dry? That pink dry would cut the beam all and get the, or is it something that's really, really iridescent and ugly? So you don't know until you wander downstairs, but that first cup of coffee, you're picking a little bit of you're cooking Halloween or cooking presents. Well, you're sort of working on something. It's like writing a story. And there's the beginning of the story, and there's the middle of the story, and then there's the climax of the story, and then there's the end of the story. But in the meantime, another story has started because, as you can see from my shelf, and as you can see from the things I have going around, there's always something going around. I have all these different tables. So there's a table for painting, there's a table for ceramics, there's a table for covering up, you know, figures and gesso work. I've got the kiln, I've got clay boards, I've got paper, I've got paint, I've got pens, I've got magnets, I've got a 3D printer, I've got a little 3D pen upstairs where I can make plastic drawings. So there's always something to play with. And if you think about it as like an adventure, like what will this material do? It's not like, well, I'm gonna make this thing, I'm gonna make more of this thing. Because then it does become production mode. You do start making a product, and when you can predict kind of the beginning, middle, and end of your own story, that like if your characters are going to be at the time and there's no surprises anymore, for me, that's a time to go from the drawing table to the painting table, or the painting table to the 3D printer, or take a walk, or go visit my neighbor, or do something else for a little while, like travel. Try something I haven't tried before. Maybe take the phone out and take some pictures and project them and draw those instead. Or go see some dance performances and try to sketch the dancers. So just try to use your eye and your hands in a different way. And when you come back down to your studio, you'll have brought the traces of all those experiences with you, and you're a different person. You're not the same person as the person that was frustrated, or the person that was stuck, or the person that knew the end of that story. So you can try something different. Or if there's a piece that bores you, you cut it in half and put it back together another way, or use it for a collage or something. Just try something else. You should have lots of different things in your studio. Go to AC Moore, go to Plaza Art, go on book.com and have an artist date for yourself. Buy some glitter, buy some stuff. Use something you never thought you'd do. Or make a list of things. I know this sounds like exhaustive, like things that Fiona does. But make a list of things that you would never do. Like, Fiona would never make a self-portrait of a letter. But what if you did make a self-portrait of a letter? What's going to happen to you? And it's this huge, dramatic composition. You could put going through it. And this figure with a single eye, right? And right where his trachea is, right? His windpipe is. And it's a collage, but it's a drawing, but it's also a sculpture. And he uses all kinds of materials so fearlessly. And I don't work like him, and I don't look like his art, but I'm so inspired whenever I see it because it's so fearless, and it's also so focused. And so artists that work with like a tremendous amount of assuredness and kind of playfulness, I guess is what I want to say. If there's a real playfulness and motion in their work, those are things I really like to look at. People that like to play with artistic process, like, there's a photographer whose work is a bit But he makes a photograph of a lake, and then uses that lake water to immerse the photograph in, so that the ink starts to lift off and become affected by the actual water of the lake itself, and then that's what you see. I'm interested in looking at those types of processes. I also, I love Martin Currier. I think he's a phenomenal sculptor. His craftsmanship, as well as his ability to enclose these really enigmatic spaces and volumes and vessels, are really, really interesting to me, because I have a background in pottery, so I'm thinking about this enclosed space and what it can hold inside it. It gives you access, but also denies you access. That's really important. Heidi Trepanier is one of my favorite painters. She's amazing. Like I said, Peters is one of my favorite sculptors. But they also have a background in, you know, they look at other painters, they look at traditional painting, look at traditional sculpture, but they're able to synthesize that and make something that's really unique with their own vision of what a figure is and what a painting is. And so when I see their work, it's something that really energizes what I do, because I see how their struggle with their materials and their dialogue with their materials and their discussion with themselves and other art have led to these amazing things.
Every one piece of paper and sit down with all your pens and your tools and your droplets and your water and your markers and stuff, and with a white piece of paper, and you just have to play. You have to try it and see. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. You know, you have to get rid of it. But if it does work, then it's kind of exciting. And things start to roll and things start to take on a sort of a life of their own. But you have to be willing to think lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of stuff. And I can show you the drawer of the undead. You can see this is really, really heavy. Like, these are, I don't want to throw them away because they weren't bad ideas. But you can see they just don't, for whatever reason, they just don't
know that I killed this sculpture. It was usually too overcut. Going in there and not knowing when to leave it alone, I move on to the next thing. And let this thing be. Just let it be alone and let it sit there for a while. Like those coils of drawings in the other room. Just let them be. Maybe a year or two, I'll unfold them. And maybe there's something in there that's going to spur the next project. I don't know that right now. So it's sort of in there. But also away from the frustration of having made it and having decided that it wasn't what I wanted. Maybe something that I could do. Or maybe I can use those materials for something else. You have to be willing to make lots of mistakes and willing to just come back to the studio when you have a desk and had a cup of coffee and some fresh air and stuff.